American History, a look at the city of Boston. Follow in the footsteps of our country's forefathers with a group of history teachers from the Florida Panhandle as they take an up-close and personal look at the historic events, people, and places that have shaped our nation. Join our history teachers as they tour throughout the Commonwealth of Massachusetts with a primary focus on the city of Boston. Other destinations in this tour include Plymouth Plantation, Salem, and Cape Cod. In this video, you'll hear stories from the deck of the Mayflower 2, an inside look at the true story behind Paul Revere's Midnight Ride, and the hysteria surrounding Salem and the witchcraft trials of 1692. Teaching American History, to raise student achievement by improving teachers' knowledge, understanding, and skills in teaching American history.
In the background, you see Mayflower 2, a replica of the four-masted bark that brought the first settlers to New England, the Pilgrims. This is a replica. It's called Mayflower 2, and it was constructed between 1955 and 1957, and eventually came across the Atlantic to become a fixture here in Plymouth in the late 1950s. It's still an active sailing vessel, and periodically takes voyages to Boston and other parts on the eastern seaboard. It's a wonderful vessel, really, inside and out. The reconstruction is very well done, and when one goes aboard, you really get a sense of what life was like, not only for the sailors who remained on the upper deck primarily, but also the passengers who were on the second deck, the oarlock deck. In the on the outside of the vessels, you see two small ships. In the bow, just a small little rowing boat. It was just called the ship's boat. And closer to the stern, you see something called a shallop, which was a one-masted vessel, very simple construction. When the Mayflower returned to England in April, the captain took the small boat with it. That was necessary for just safety, if nothing else, and of course from getting to the vessel, to back and forth from the vessel to shore. But he left the shallop, and so that shallop, or this reconstruction of the shallop, represents really the first coastal sailing vessel that the newcomers had, used for something that we called cabotage, or going for small distances from port to port.
So a great tall man, he got short black hair in front, long down his back, he ain't wearing naught but a little leather about his privities, and then he spread his arms, and in English he says, "Greetings, Englishman." Yeah, we know it fell over. His name, it seems now, is Samoset. He come from the Isle of Man, north and east by here. And he's a Pinnice, he says. It's sort of like a knight at home, a man of some importance. Now, you've got to realize, fishermen been 70 or 80 years working this coastline for many different countries out of Europe. And so there are some, and there's been trading going on with the coastal native people, and some can be understood to different European languages. And for his position to his group, well, he was a man who could be understood to English. And he explained, he's on some sort of a trading mission or something down here. I don't know why he's down in these parts, but he says the natives what live off closest by, 35 or 40 miles to the inland, they got a man amongst them can speak English more better than him. And he says, I'll gather him up. And he comes back a couple of 3 days later with one he calls Squanto. And Squanto, he speaks English as well as you or I. And with the help of them too, they then brought in the emperor, king of them, this man, Massasoit. And that man, now he has signed a treaty and an alliance with these settlers. All for the help of these two understood the English. It seems there shall be good relation here. Now, much different to Jamestown, where there's been fighting right from the start down there for 13 years. But here, it seems there'll be some fair relation amongst the settlers and these folks here.
What's your first call to duty now that you're here to set up camp?
Oh, well, to carve a little bit of a housing set out of this forest. I mean, cut timber and build them housing. They got 6 dwellings and a storehouse built. That got the whole of them off the ship by the end of February. Now we're just waiting for the weather to improve, and it is all for them to start planting crops. And one another reason this was chosen was the natives what had lived here, had they been farmers as well, and there's 70 acres of open corn ground not yet overtaken by the forest, so their first task shall not be clearing land to make fields, but to put crops to the ground, and now they do prepare themselves for that.
And you going back in the year or so?
Oh, no, we're going back now. Oh, I'm part of the crew. We've only been hired to bring them here. We're not staying with them. We've overwintered only due to our late arrival. Our intent was to have them here by late in September. They'd have housing built quickly in October, mayhaps in November sometime we'd be gone for home. We never intended to spend 5 months in this wilderness. No, we thought the round trip of it would be 5 months. But we've overwintered for Jones, our ship's master. He wouldn't cast them out on the shore with nowhere to live. Right to the onset of winter, he let them continue to stay on board the ship. If he'd asked us in the ship's crew, we'd have very gently put their belongings on the shore and gone for home. But he says he'll not leave them till he sees them proper housed in a safe harbor. And that took months. We're 4.5 months here in New England now.
Were you accurate in your mapping?
Oh, this old coastline's well charted. When we sighted land at 42 degrees, we known it was Cape of Cod. We tried, without even going ashore, to go south and west around it, for they did not intend to plant themselves this far north. They actually bought the rights to land at Master Hudson's River, south and west of here. That's the northern edges of Virginia. And from the Virginia Company did their investors buy their patent or their license. But trying to round that cape, contrary weather was right on our face, and square-rigged as we are, we can't sail close into the wind. And shallows and shoals, sandbars and the like outside this cape, wouldn't let us pass. After a day of trying, Jones, the master, and the leaders amongst them settlers, they did decide to come back inside this cape. They'll look around for the best place to settle and plant themselves up here. So they did not intend to put themselves this far north, but it was not a narrow navigation. We known where we were the whole time. We just couldn't get them where they had bought land, and thus they are squatters on the land here. They have just made use of it, for they had to do something. So long had they been aboard the ship. They're a rather pious lot, but they don't mind breaking the law when it suits them. They got no lawful right to this land. When we go home, they say our ship's master shall inform their investors that they are in a harbor called Plymouth. And John Smith charts in New England, the Council of New England, their land, not the Virginia Company's land. And the pettifoggers will come to it, the lawyers, and money will change hands. And they say their patent shall be adjusted one company to the next. But they got no right to the land here at all, but it don't seem to trouble them much.
I'm skinning an otter. This is a river otter. And right now what I'm doing, I've pretty much slit it down the belly, just the fur. You know, you don't want to nick the meat because you don't want to necessarily make a mess or make a lot more work for yourself. And what I do is kind of peel back the skin a little bit. And what I'm doing is using mostly just the top edge of my knife to separate the membrane that's around the muscle from the skin. And then once I've completely skinned the animal, all I really have to do is clean off any of the excess membrane, excess meat, so it's all sort of this clean gray, grayish-white layer. And then at that point, what you do is you can either dry it and leave it as rawhide until you want to tan it and use the leather, or what we'll do is we'll take the brain of the animal make it into a paste, and you stretch the hide out so it doesn't shrink as it dries, and then you rub that paste in, and you get a beautiful, very, very soft leather called brain tan leather. The native people knew that there was a chance that their interactions with the European, the English in particular, would not be very good. And for instance, there were people who were kidnapped prior to settlement here by the European. There were slavers by the English that were brought back to England and made slaves or put on exhibit in cages for many years. Some had managed to escape and make their way back here, and so they had learned English. And how they escaped was they would barter with the missionaries and agree to be interpreters for the missionaries, and they would come back here and they would escape. So there were a few people that spoke English, and they knew that there was a chance that their interactions may be very bad. Also, up north, when ships were coming in to the beaches, the natives there were very welcoming, and they sent out women and children. And eventually you'd see that they wouldn't send out women and children in canoes to greet the ships anymore, because they were being, abused. Many bad things would happen to them, or they simply wouldn't come back. So they stopped. They stopped with the friendly interaction with the English early on. So both groups of people were leery of each other. The English didn't approve of the Native American way of life. It was completely opposite as far as society goes. For instance, the men and women here wouldn't have as much clothing on in the spring and the summertime. And women were not sexually objectified the way they are in modern day society. So for a woman to be topless, no one would think anything of it. It wouldn't even cross anyone's mind, because that part of your body is used to feed your children. So why would you have a tarnished, concept of that part of a woman's body? It's disrespectful. So the English didn't approve of that, though. They believed the more clothes on and the less skin you were showing, the better. And they didn't bathe every day like the Native American people did. They bathed once every couple of months. And they believed that cleanliness was the furthest thing from holiness. And in our society, we believed that you had to bathe every day and stay clean. That was part of our belief system.
Cattails?
Cattails?
Cattail root, yep.
And what are you going to be ultimately using it for?
The women are going to weave these. Well, we're going to actually all weave them in the wintertime and weave them into mats for the summer home. Right now, I'm just going to split these up, and then we're going to put them in little bundles, and then we're going to sun dry them, and then we're going to weave them in the winter into mats. And it's similar to that house behind you, where it's... The cattail reeds, the ones on the inside are going to be put on the outside, and then the ones we're going to make are going to be put on the inside, and then they just keep rotating like that. So.
What would you like to know? It was built by Master Bradford, and most of the men have lodgers in the house as well. So they will together hew logs and cut timbers, and might hire a carpenter to put the frame together. Francis Eaton is one of the carpenters here.
How long does it take to construct?
These houses are pretty small. I would say just a couple of months. And then clapboards on the outside and thatch on the roof, and then the clay daub in between the studs. made of clay and straw and sand and the like, squished into wattles. There are sticks in between the studs. So wattle and daub.
Oh, the native men.
The natives.
Yeah, well, their village is, what, 40 English miles from here?
Yeah.
Some such as that?
Yeah, it is only Hobomok.
Mm. Hobomok and his family, they live by the brook here as a go-betwixt. My husband, Master William Bradford, and Maza Zowit, the king of the native men here. They are peaceful and generous, and they help us find, in the first years, they help my husband find where food was. How to find eels in the brooks, and where to find berries, and how to plant the corn here. The Indians' corn is planted in a more different manner than you would English corn, by sketching it in the ground. Here you must dig pits in the earth and bury herring fish, not every year of course, but building up mounds and allowing the fish to rot for a fortnight, which is a wretched thing. The stench is overwhelming sometimes. And then you plant the corn where the fish is rotted. And my husband tells me that in the great drought of 1603 and 20, it might have been the rotting fish beneath which allowed enough water to come into the corn to save it until God allowed rain come. In the summer of 1603 and 20, there was no rain from May all the way into July, about the time we arrived here. Yes, please come in, don't stand in the street.
I should make my way to my other labours, I thank you so kindly.
Oh, I thank you, Bridget, it always pleases me to see thee. My sister-in-law lives just down the street. My brother-in-law serves as deacon to our church here, so I suspect she's most likely going to tend to his dinners.
That was ironic. That's actually going to be my next question. Coming over from England, if you were able to establish a church and bring a deacon with you.
Oh, yes. We brought two. Master John Carver was also here before I come here, and he was a deacon to our church as well, but God saw fit to take him from this vale of tears. So he left us in the spring of 1601 and 20, and I do not know if at that time they had good relations with the Pokanoket Nation, but my husband finds them very useful, for not only in to help us where the food was in the first years, but trading. As now, I know not if you've seen the wealth of what this world can offer, besides my cabbages, but my husband trades the native men beads and knives and such things for furs of animals. This is a beaver pelt. My husband tells me it's worth about 12 shillings in the London market. So we are able to take these for what is trinkets. A knife that we purchase at halfpenny in the markets fetches out furs. So it's an excellent trade for us. And we found that north and east of here by the Kennebunk and Saco River is the Tarentine Nation, and they will give us the furs of animals for our corn. The maize corn, the surplus harvest of the entire colony, is brought north of here and traded for furs of animals.
It seems pretty fair and equitable for both parties.
Truly. It is that we need each other in this place. As I find it, my husband says that we shall not survive here by ourselves without good supply out of England and the trade of the native men. And I think it's a wise man who can say that he need help.
Are you homesick?
I'm sorry.
Are you homesick?
No, I miss my family. I have two children, and my mother and my sister are still in the old world. But I have a good husband here and a roof over my head. A promise of owning land next year. So I don't miss the filth and corruption of the cities I was raised in. But I do miss beer, and I do miss a good oat cake with honey. But no, them things will come here in time. It just takes time, my husband says.
My job for all of our groups who are outside before your tour is to separate the facts from the myths around Paul Revere's ride very briefly. And almost everyone in this country knows that Paul Revere made a ride on a horse at the very beginning of the American Revolution. And many people have in their minds an image of Paul Revere that looks something like this, a dashing young man on a horse shouting out something into the night. But this is not what Revere really looked like. So most people have this image, but not everyone knows what the purpose of Paul Revere's ride was. Do you know? What was his mission on the night of April 18, 1775?
The British land arrived by land or by sea, hang the land in the loft.
All right. So there's something about lanterns and something about British troops. Paul Revere's specific mission was to go from this very house out into the countryside to warn two men, not every Middlesex village and farm, but two men, Samuel Adams and John Hancock, that they were thought to be in grave danger of being arrested by hundreds of British regulars who were moving from Boston. Those regulars had been camped out here in the city off and on already for 7 years. This was an occupied city. And Revere and his friends, who called themselves the Sons of, were worried that those troops were going out to arrest these two revolutionary leaders. Paul Revere left from this house, but he did not get on a horse right away. We don't think he even owned a horse at that time. And even if he had owned a horse, would not have used it on that night. Why not? How did he leave Boston? What was his method of transportation? I'm sure some of you know. A little rowboat. And while there were ferries you could put a horse in when you were going across from Boston to Charlestown, you would never try and put a full-grown horse into a little rowboat. This is a map showing you how Boston was shaped at the time of the Revolution. It was a very small place, almost an island. Paul Revere's house was and still is right here on this map. The quickest way for Revere to get to Lexington was to cross the water here in that rowboat to Charlestown, borrow a horse there, and then set off on his mission. I understand that you're going to the Old North Church, so I'm not going to even talk about those lanterns because you'll hear more about them over there. Paul Revere borrowed a horse in Charlestown and then set off on his mission. And most Americans, and perhaps even you, believe that Revere was shouting something as he galloped along. What do most people think Revere shouted? But why would it have been foolish for Revere to gallop along shouting anything? Who would have heard him?
The
right? Yes. Revere knew that the roads would be heavily guarded on that night. So he went very quietly. He was on a secret mission, and if you're on a secret mission, it's a bad idea to go around shouting. So he went very quietly. He did knock on the doors of local people along his route. But his main mission was to get to Lexington. Now, did Paul Revere finish his mission? Shake your heads, yes or no? I know why you're saying no, but he did finish his mission. Joseph Warren, a leader of the Sons of Liberty, had sent Revere specifically to Lexington. Revere made it to Lexington, but so too did another rider. Do you know his name? Good job. Yes, William Dawes. The Sons of Liberty tried to leave nothing to chance, and William Dawes actually left before Revere did. He went the long way around out the Boston Neck. That was a very circuitous route to take. Because his route was longer, he arrived in Lexington after Revere did. But they both finished their mission. And then, apparently on their own, Revere and Dawes decided to press onwards. The Sons of Liberty were also worried that the British regulars might go further down the road to Concord to take something that the Patriots had stored there. What was in Concord? Ammunition, yes. And as Revere and Dawes went further, what happened to Paul Revere? He was captured, held for a few hours. The regulars held a gun to his head and threatened to blow out his brains, but they didn't do it. They released him. Dawes disappeared into the night, and Dr. Prescott, another rider who had joined in with them by chance, he had been up rather late at night visiting his girlfriend in Lexington and was on his way home to Concord. He jumped his horse over a wall and alerted people in that further town. So Revere finished his mission. He was arrested. Both of those statements are true and not contradictory. But Revere was not famous for that ride when he was alive. Hundreds of people, men, women, blacks, whites, got on horses and delivered important messages during the course of the American Revolution. They were all important. Many of them, though, have been forgotten. And Revere was pretty much forgotten, too, until the year 1860. Local people knew about him, but not people in the rest of the country. What transformed Revere into an enduring symbol of patriotism? Yes, so this is a great way you can use Revere to teach all the way across the curriculum, linking literature with history studies, because Revere became famous through that poem. that poem was a hit. The way CDs become hits today or songs on iTunes, and that poem made Revere famous. Have you read the poem? Any? So you know that the poem is a wonderful piece of literature, never intended to be taken as a factual account of what had transpired on that night. It is so lucky that Longfellow did make Revere famous. Revere's life would not have been studied intensively were it not for Longfellow. But Revere turns out to be a fascinating person, not as a leader of the revolution, but as someone more in the middle. And luckily, many clues remained behind that could tell people about who he was. There was even a fabulous portrait of Revere by John Singleton Copley, so people could see what he looked like. Many of Revere's letters had been saved. His own accounts of his midnight ride had been preserved, so people could find out what his mission was and what he had been asked to do. The biggest clue that remained, however, was his house. And it was amazing that the house was still here. This house was already 90 years old when Paul Revere bought it in 1770. The house was built around 1680 for a very wealthy man. But by the time Revere bought it, it was more of a fixer-upper, kind of out of fashion, right in Revere's price range as a middle-class silversmith. And what's this house made out of? Wood. So what's the problem with a wooden house in a city that was already as crowded as this? It wasn't, I know, because you're from the South. And it wasn't termites either. It was something else. Fire, right, was the big fear. We're right here in this engraving of the North End. So this, there was another wooden house here and one over where that brick building now stands. But what Revere could afford was not a brick modern house, but an old medieval-looking wooden house like this. It was perfect for him and his family. It was because it was very large. You'll hear more about his family inside. And this house was, when he lived here, when Revere lived here, was much bigger than what you are seeing today. There was an addition on this corner and a much bigger third floor on the house, too.
In those days, there were kingdoms. So they could have been the Revois family, they could have been the Reviore family, could have been Italian or French. We know his family came to Boston. They were French Huguenots by the time they got here, and Revois, and then they changed their name to Revere. The statue is by Cyrus Dahlen. Cyrus Dahlen was the son of a Mormon family from outside of Salt Lake. He chose not to be a Mormon. He was educated in Boston and in Paris. As a sculptor, and he's most famous for his statues of American Indian. He grew up as a child with Indian children, and therefore he was very sympathetic to them. Now, this was put here only in the 1930s when this mall or Prado was built to commemorate the centennial of the American Revolution, or tercentenary of the American Revolution. And you can see it really connects the neoclassic St. Stephen's Church with the Georgian Old North Church. Now, St. Stephen's is on over here, and pardon me for pointing, but over there, St. Stephen's is on the site where there was always a Protestant church. It was called New North. Charles Bulfinch, again, designed this very delicate neoclassical church. Paul Revere made the bell, did the copper work. With the great Irish immigration, this became a Catholic church in the 19th century. It's today St. Stephen's. And Rose Kennedy was both baptized in the church, and her funeral was held from the church. 100 years before, they were building neoclassical churches, still copying the London churches of Sir Christopher Wren. Again, because of the huge rainstorms we've had, the trees are so full, you can't see the steeple, but you will when you see me pointing up. We're going to get close to it. All right? So we're going to go up to the North Church, or as they say here, Old North. Now we're going to go into the North Church, or Christ Church, in just a moment, and a member of the church will tell you its history. In 1954, we had one of the great destructive hurricanes that did huge damage to New England. The second steeple, because this is the third steeple, and again you'll hear about that, the second steeple broke off during the hurricane, came down like an ice cream cone, and hit the tenements across the street. So there are actually in existent or extant historic films of this steeple just touching the building before it exploded into splinters. So what you're going to see today is the third and probably the most authentic recreation, because other storms took down the first of the North Church steeples. So we're going to go across the street. But when I point up on the very edge of the tenement, you'll see the chip out of the corner. It's where the steeple hit it.
And welcome to the Old North Church. Well, that's actually the church's nickname. Its official name is Christ Church in the city of Boston. And it was founded in 1723, which makes it Boston's oldest standing church building. It was founded as an Anglican church, Church of England, and loyal to the king. And most of the members here were very wealthy. They paid a large rental fee for their pew here in the church. That was how you joined the congregation. You bought your seat and sat in the same one every week. And the most expensive were front and center. So they did indicate social standing. Now, the pews are called box pews, and they might look strange today, but they were very common in churches built at that time. You simply couldn't heat a building this big in the 1700s, so you would bring a foot warmer, like the ones you see on the windowsills. You would put hot coals from your fireplace in there, put that on the floor of your pew, and the high sides and the doors that close would help to contain the warmth. Now, the pews were also decorated by their owners. This was not a Puritan church, so there were no strict rules against decoration. The pews would have looked like the red one on my right, that's lined in brocade fabric and has cushions and furniture from home. It's a lot more decorative. So if you had come into the church in the 1700s, you would have seen a whole patchwork of all different colors. But you would not have seen Paul Revere's pew, because Paul Revere was never a member of this church. He was a Puritan. His only involvement was as a young teenager, when he and his friends formed the very first bell ringing guild here at the Old North Church. And they would come once a week to ring the bells for 2 cents in pay. Now, the person who was a member many years later, at the beginning of the Revolution, was General Thomas Gage, the last royal governor of the colony of Massachusetts. In April in 1775, General Gage was sending British troops toward Lexington and Concord. In Lexington, he wanted Samuel Adams and John Hancock arrested. They were key figures within the network of spies known as the Sons of Liberty. In Concord, he wanted the ammunition and weapons stockpiled by the Patriots all confiscated. Now, without weapons and without leaders, they felt they couldn't very well start a war. But General Gage's plans were leaked, and the Sons of Liberty back here in Boston found out about the march on Lexington and Concord. So they planned a famous message ride to warn their fellow patriots. And Paul Revere was not the only rider, just the only one who had a poem written about him. You see, there were 10 to 12 riders all going out in different directions, and there was a good chance that they could be arrested along their route. So they needed a firm backup plan in case patrol soldiers would think of them suspicious and intercept them along their way. So Paul Revere suggested a good backup plan. He knew from his time as a bell ringer here that this church stood on one of the highest points in Boston. So a signal from its steeple would be easily seen all around, even across the river in Charlestown. So he warned members of the Sons of Liberty and the militia in Charlestown to look toward the Old North Church. If they saw one lantern light, they would know the troops had left and they were marching by land. And if they saw two lantern lights, the troops were going directly across the Charles River in boats, which would take about 10 miles and 4 hours off their land-only march. So it was important to know which way they went. Now, once Paul Revere had given the information and the signal went up, the riders out in Charlestown would get on their horses and take the message to Concord. The person who actually lit the lanterns was not Revere. It was Robert Newman, the sexton of this church, the groundskeeper, and the only person with the key. He came here on the night of April 18th through the doors you all came through, and then he locked them behind him, and he went up one of the stairways at the back and through a door behind a pipe organ that led into the steeple. He climbed 161 steps up to its highest level, where he lit and held out two lanterns for just under a minute to show that the troops were crossing the river. And then he blew out the candles and came down as quickly as he could. But not only had the colonists seen the lanterns, so had a curfew patrol. They were here to investigate, banging with muskets on the locked doors. So Robert Newman ran down one of these aisles and escaped through the darkened window on my left with the lantern hanging in it, which we now call the Newman window in his honor. And he did get home safely. He lived very close. However, he was arrested on suspicion soon after. He was, after all, the only person with a key to the church. So it didn't take long to figure out he must be involved. However, there was no proof against him. No one had ever seen him enter or leave the church building. So he could not be put on trial for treason, and he was eventually released. And the rest is history. But it was Robert Newman's brave actions here that made the Old North so important in our revolutionary tradition. And we do have a lot of other interesting items and stories. I'll just point out a few quick things. The chandeliers in the center aisle date back to 1724. They were here in time for the first Christmas service, and they do still get lit for evening services and weddings in the church even today. Candlelight is the only light on this floor. The clock at the back is the oldest functioning clock in a public building in the nation. It was made by two members of this church in 1726, and they had never made a clock before, so they did an excellent job for their first try. The pipe organ was one of the first built in the colonies, and its casing is original to 1759. It's still played every week in Sunday service. And the wooden chest at the back of our center aisle is carved CC for Christ Church, and with the date 1724. It's original and was used to hold church documents and church money. That's our donation box, and it still works too. You're all welcome to give it a try.
Okay, we're in a burying ground. There's more than 1,000 people buried here. Now, originally when the Puritans and then the Anglicans planted their dead, they were put in the ground. If they were average Joe, they were wrapped in muslin with some burial pins to hold them together and put in the ground. If you were a merchant or rich, you could have a pine box. And if you were super rich, you could either have a vault down underneath or a large gravestone like over yonder. Now, most of the slate for these graves came from Slate Island in Boston Harbor. This is where the Indians used to get their arrowheads, and later where the early colonists in Boston got their roof shingles for the houses. The winters have taken their toll. In the 19th century, some people tried to preserve them by putting concrete around them or copper, and of course it did more damage than good because the snow and the rain got in. Now, during the American Revolution, the British Army was bivouacked up here with their heavy cannons. This was the cannon battery, and the British soldiers were bored, so look, they did target practice. This one got the skull right in the eyeball, but they actually did target practice on these gravestones. Now the grave over here, the tall black one, that is the Prince Hall grave, and Prince Hall headed Boston's first black Masonic order, because for a short period, this corner of the North End was a black community. It was black, English, then it was Irish and Italian, and today it's all yuppies. All right? Now, people didn't die in nice, neat rows like this. Originally, when you were buried, you were put in the ground with a large gravestone at your head and a smaller one at your feet, kind of like a big bed. But in the 19th century, someone invented the lawnmower. For the first time, they could cut the grass. So they pulled up all the gravestones and put them in parallel rows. And except for the most important, we lost track of where anyone is. So there's people under you, behind you, over you, all over the place. They're all over. Now, about 20 years ago, during a winter storm, one of the walls collapsed from frost heaves. The snow pushed it over, and it ripped open a vault. And there was an old lady up in one of those tenements. She's long dead. She called the police, and she kept saying in her Italian accent, "Da body, da body." And they thought she was a little touched. Turned out she was looking across at a shattered tomb, and she did indeed see part of a skeleton. When the police finally figured it out and they got up here with all their flashing lights, there wasn't a bone to be found. Then they noticed every dog in the neighborhood had a bone. Well, anyway, that happened. They also found a sword, and one of the kids took it home with them, and they had to negotiate with the family to get the sword back. So this is called Cop's Hill. It has nothing to do with the police, cop. It has to do with a family that actually were early merchants in the North End. This is also called Windmill Hill because there was a windmill up here. It's a very breezy spot. And it's also called Snow Hill. Now, I'm sure they told you in the North Church there were another 1,000 under you, right? Did you notice in the base of the North Church on the outside, the little vents? That's for methane gas that comes out of the vaults. No longer can we light a match and see anything, but just in case. It was here on Lexington Green that Captain Parker, the American commander, stood with 77 men. It was before dawn. The The British Army was on the march from Boston. He told his men, hold fast, stand your ground. Don't fire unless fired upon. If they want a war, let it begin here. Since the British Army was miles away, Captain Parker ordered his men to return to their farms or go next door into Buckman's Tavern for fortification. Finally, the British Army was spotted on the green, coming toward the town. Little William Diamond was sent out onto the green to beat his drum, and the Minutemen came back onto the green. Captain Parker's scouts informed him that there were more than 700 British soldiers. He had less than 100, so he ordered his men to withdraw from the green. As the Americans were withdrawing from the green, the British Army came flowing into the town around both sides of the church and belfry. A shot was fired. The British officer's horse was hit. And then the British Army fired a volley into the back of the fleeing American residents. Some of them swung around and got a shot off before they died where they stood. Others were wounded to die of horrible wounds. British officers rode up and down, ordering their men to cease firing, and eventually the British Army was gotten into order. Three cheers, three huzzas were given. They had dispersed this rebel rabble army, but they had missed their mark. Because a mile from here, Hancock and Adams were escaping in a coach to the Second Continental Congress in Philadelphia. And the British missed their mark. On the ledges, yes. So this is called the Witch Memorial. And if you walk around in a horseshoe pattern, you'll take a look, you'll see that they were killed off in batches. Again, we're going kind of hind backward, because when you get to the museum itself, you'll hear the whole story. So if you want to take a look now, and then we're going to just walk through this is the oldest burying ground in Salem. All right, so just take a look at the name. Some of them might start to sound familiar to you. Ma'am, the Grand Court. You'll hear all about it when you go. You're going to be part of it. You'll hear the. It was the government. The government that was up here when the royal governor in Boston got wind of it, especially after his own wife was accused of being a witch in his absence. He put an end to it entirely. Queen Elizabeth II pardoned all the witches in 1959. No, just the dead ones.
How were they buried? Were they buried in a traditional burial?
They were not buried in hollow ground. They could not be buried in sanctified ground. This was a Puritan community. So they were taken either to family burial places. One was buried in the basement of his own home. And they were taken off and disposed of by the families. Again, you get into the witchcraft of that period. It was a covenant with the devil. So it's...
And they were not given ecclesiastical traditional burials as we know it with the priest?
This is not Church of England.
Oh.
This was kind of an unsanctified, not wrong word,
unsanctioned
religious sect that had broken away from the mainstream English. This was the Puritan colony. So again, the church was supreme here. The ministers made the final determination according to their interpretation of how they looked at the Bible and whatever else was written.
And very quickly, what were some of the, I know there were ridiculous tests that they used to determine.
Well, one is called a witch pin, which is a metal clamp put on the body, and if it made a bruise, as it would on most people, then it was the mark of the devil.
And then the dunking seat?
No, that's a very separate issue. That was in Boston.
Okay.
In Boston, if you were accused of being a witch, male or female, you were strapped in the dunking stool and dunked in the pond.
Okay.
If you drowned, you were innocent. If you came up alive, you were guilty, then they hanged you. Here in the Witch Memorial, you can see at the entrance there are the broken statements from testimony of those accused of being witches, and they are broken off in mid-sentence to show us that the originals were muzzled during the trial. They weren't allowed to have their say, their open say, in the witchcraft trial, and therefore they weren't able to defend and save themselves. Trials was a gentleman named Hathorne. This is the family plot of the Hathornes. One of his descendants was Nathaniel Hawthorne. He was so embarrassed by the horrible things his ancestor did, he changed his own name. So this is why it says Hathorne. That's the original family name. There's another person buried in here. The captain of the Mayflower from Plymouth. You know, the Mayflower went back and forth three times and the ship finally was broken up, but the captain's up here. All right? This was a Puritan colony, area. These were a Protestant sect who had broken with the Church of England. They did not, they were trying to purify it. They didn't agree with it. When they were over here, they ran their churches on their own without any divine guidance from London. The King of England was the head of the Church of England. He was not their religious leader. And therefore, the witchcraft hysteria, all of the things that went on, were guided by the tenets of the way they practiced their religion. They had an idea about sanctified ground that's not unlike the Catholic Church or the Anglican Church or anything else, and they did not want the witches buried, anyone who had had a covenant with the devil, anywhere near them. So the families took the bodies away. One guy was buried in the cellar of his own house. That's where the family hid him, because they were afraid that if the public dug him up, they'd hang him from a tree or something. Oh. Well, it was a hysteria. Really was. This is the Gardner Pingree House, named for two families that owned it. It's the epitome of Salem graceful Federalist architecture. Again, all the elements that we saw, the demi-lune, half of a moon doorway, the Roman columns, the neoclassical refinement, the shorter third floor, the cornice, the hip roof, which is a low flattish roof, the tall chimneys, all Federal architecture. Mostly always thought of Salem and sometimes Savannah. Sometimes you see houses like this down in the south. Again, in London, they would be Regency houses. Extremely rare for Salem is to have your carriage house survive. So this was attached to the house. This is the original carriage house where the coaches and horses would have been kept. And today, as you see, it's been turned into a studio. For many years, there was a little ice cream store here called Sweet Scoops, and it was run by an Armenian couple whose name was Columbosian, but you know them because they founded Columbo Yogurt, and they started it in Salem or nearby. Now, the house off to the right with the tall chimneys is the only house left still with a ballroom attached. It's got the ballroom on where this carriage house would be on the other side of that house. That's been turned into a assisted living for wealthy ladies and gentlemen. But the big houses surround the common. Now, the Witch Museum, where we're going next, was a 19th century Gothic church, beautiful Gothic church, but it was destroyed in a great fire right down to the walls. So you're going inside to see an exhibit of what led up to the witchcraft hysteria, which you'll see inside the lobby of the church. Then you're going to go into the former auditorium, which is all a huge dark theater with screens, and see the story of the witchcraft hysteria. And then when you come out, there's another exhibit that talks about witchcraft and what it is and what it isn't. So let's all go get bewitched.
Welcome to the famous Salem Witch Museum. We are going to show you the witchcraft trials which took place in Salem Village in 1692. Do you believe in witches? Millions of your ancestors did. Worship of the powers of evil, of the forces behind storm and sickness and drought and death was man's first religion, and the witch was its priestess. Long after Christianity had come, it survived in secret. On the witch's Sabbath, the covens of 13 would gather around their magic 9-foot circle. A fire would be lit beneath the cauldron. The scourge and pentacle and Hathame, a black-handled sacrificial knife would appear, and the ancient ritual invoking the evil one would begin. To the good folk of Salem in 1692, the devil and witchcraft were realities. They could hear him in the howling of wolves, in the creaking of an old house on a winter's night. They lived in dread of the Indians, of diseases such as smallpox, which killed their children without reason, of the home government in England even, which had threatened to take away their lands and their charter. Fear was the climate of their lives. And for hours every Sunday, their ministers warned them against the devil, the Prince of Darkness, who was everywhere. Whispered evil thoughts into the minds of the unguarded, tempting them to sign his book, to sell their souls for power and riches in this life. He it was who met with half-married old women in the forest to perform unspeakable rites, who threatened us all with eternal damnation. Satan. He had come to New England so preachers like Cotton Mather said to undo God's kingdom, setting snares for the unwary, forever watching, watching, waiting to claim his own.
Who would have thought that the Salem witchcraft hysteria would have started with three little girls playing with an egg white in a glass? It was a tale told to them by Tituba, a slave in the home of Reverend Samuel Parris. Imagine these girls growing up in the home of a minister, and they are dabbling with magic and witchcraft, the fear of being found out. To their surprise, what the egg appeared in the glass to form was a coffin. It scared them to death. They went hysterical. The Reverend had no idea what was wrong with them, so he called in Dr. William Griggs, who quickly identified the girls as having an evil hand upon them because he could find nothing wrong with them medically speaking. From there, it just spread through Salem. A number of people were accused of witchcraft. A number of people were hanged. In all, there were 19 that were killed, hung. There was one that was pressed to death, a man by the name of Giles Corey. There were also three that died in prison awaiting trial for witchcraft. During that time, it was a bad time in Salem. There were smallpox epidemics. They were having a lot of problems financially and with the farms. So it was easy for people to believe that their bad times in their village were caused by Satan and the devil and evilness and witchcraft. Several people were accused. Some of the most famous names: Rebecca Nurse, Sarah Osborne, Sarah Good, who went to prison with her 4-year-old daughter Dorcas Good. The way out after it all ended, the thing that brought it to an end, was when the girls actually accused Lady Phipps, the wife of the governor.
of Massachusetts when they began to accuse them and Samuel Willard, president of Harvard College. It pretty well became known that something wasn't right, that these girls couldn't be really naming witches. These people were just too important in society to be considered witches. So the governor of Massachusetts stepped in, Governor Phipps, and he ended the witchcraft trials in Salem.
Not only were women accused of being witches, there also were several examples in Salem of men as well. One was a man by the name of George Burroughs, and it was thought in that particular time that if you could not recite the Lord's Prayer, then you would be a witch. Well, he was able to actually recite it, but wound up being hung anyway. Another example was a guy named John Proctor, who along with his wife, both were accused eventually of witchcraft. His wife later was released from prison. She was with child, but John was hung as a result of that. So you had both men and women who were accused of witchcraft in Salem during this time period. Another interesting thing to consider, though, is the idea of accusations of hysteria throughout the United States has continued on even into more modern times. Two examples would be with World War II. After the bombing of Pearl Harbor, you had the Japanese Americans. We were very concerned that they might somehow, you know, help to carry out an attack or something here on the mainland, and we wound up interning them into camps. And another example also would be with communism, with the fear of that, and McCarthy and the different raids that were convicted with people during that particular time, too.